Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to be starting with our monthly meeting, the Fort Lincoln Civic Association meeting. And it's April 18, 2013. First, we're going to have a minute of silence, prayer, or reflection. However you serve, when you serve. If I may close the eyes. Amen. We're going to have the roll call of the board. Little Griffin, Cannon Village, that's me, present. Mary Honeyblue, Sunny Village.
Present.
Bernadette White, High New Court. She called and said she might not be able to. Say, if she didn't make the meeting tonight, we'll know why. Because she went to the doctor and she had a kind of a rough day and she came home taking some medication. I guess relapse, so she might not be able to make it. And Washington Overlook, we still have a vacancy there. No one has stepped up to represent that housing complex as yet. Bernice Green from the Westfield House, senior apartment. Mary Burgess, Fort Lincoln apartment, 2855 Lakeview Road.
Here.
Queen Brown, Pittsburgh apartment.
Present.
Janet Peterson, Dakota Crossing.
Present.
Kat Pierce, Hillside 2 condo,
here.
Zia Dick, Mapleview condo. She called me and said that she wouldn't be able to make it. She had an emergency that came up with her sister, so
she just locked it up.
So that kind of took her away.
Oh, it's okay, everybody. She's still out there?
She planned to come back to the meeting. Bobby Smith, Gettysburg apartment. Villages at Dakota Crossing and Steel Basin. No one has stepped up to represent that complex as yet. And Tallulah, Gilliam, Petersburg apartments, 3298 Fort Lincoln. I called her to remind of the meeting. She said she was going to have some shortness of breath, so she wouldn't be able to make it. Election 2013. We have to pick a chair by that committee and report by the commissioner, Manny, by 5C04, and then the panel discussion, an experiment in community budgeting. This is reflecting our attempt to have our first home tour in May, that's May 11th. So, and then we have the business and announcement with the crime report from the district. So I want to say to the audience, please hold your questions and comments until we get to the new business and questions and comments, because the board have about to vote on, we have a certain time to do that voting. So when we get to that, you'll be able to speak. So, next thing in the treasury report by Bernadette White, she's not here. So we didn't have any actions in April. You might look at the financial report in your packet. So we did have, in March, we paid $80 for incorporating the DCRA semi-annual fee for incorporation for the organization. So that left us $348.98. Everybody see you? Okay, we had $40, but we paid for the federation membership, annual federation membership, and then we paid $80 for the cooperation, which came to $120. Yeah, so that left us in the bank at $368. $348.98. So we need to appoint a chairperson for the nominating committee. We have to vote on one.
That's what we
did. If anybody want to be the nominating committee chair or appoint somebody, maybe Roy would do it for us this year. Yeah, for the elections. But I think he would like to be relieved, so maybe down the line we can find somebody who would chair that committee. So, what would be the 16th of May. And we thought it would be kind of close, just coming out of a home tour and going into election. So that was kind of a big tour to do at that time. So I was wondering if the board would okay for the 23rd for our annual meeting.
At the very end. They're supposed to provide security until the very end.
Okay, then, next thing, we need to vote on reimbursement to Mr. Pearson for the monies that he spent for our home tour. So we're going to have to vote on that. He spent our $1,263.64. And for that, he got 1 3-foot. By 18-foot vine banner. He got 116-yard sign, 116-wide staple, 500 tickets, 10 plastic counter holders for flyers, and one large poster. And there was more he had, but he said he ate that, so all we have to pay is $1,263.64, and that $260 was for designing of the tickets, the yard sign, designing of the yard sign, and the posters and the banners. Like I said, $260. He's not charged.
Let me provide a little bit of context. Most of these expenses were supposed to have been met by Brentwood Business Center, which said they would provide, they have a big vinyl machine, they make banners, all this kind of stuff. They owed us almost $1,000 credit that we're going to use for this purpose. When it came time for them to actually perform, though, it was a whole different story. and we finally got out of them, I think, something like 1,400 color flyers, but they didn't prepare the banners, posters, et cetera, and claimed that we had already exhausted our credit. They had no records produced to contradict our records showing that we had only used about $90, mostly for meeting flyers, during the course of the last 10 months, and we provided them with free advertising in return for $1,000 worth of printing and photocopying. So we were left at the last minute to scramble to come up with how we're going to fund banners, and because we're going to be outside Costco, it was the first weekend, it was last weekend, with the banner, posters, some of which would tell people buy advance tickets ahead, other with the plain yard signs we're going to use throughout Fort Lincoln. And so I offered to contingency that I would advance the cost if and would be reimbursed out of future proceeds from the sale of sponsorships and tickets. If it wasn't sufficient to reimburse me, then I would just consider it a charitable contribution for the amount that was not collected. We've already gotten close to $2,000 in commitments from Wells Fargo, from Fort Lincoln Cemetery, Fort Lincoln Funeral Home, from Fort Lincoln Pharmacy, and one other entity. Off the top of my head, I don't remember what it is. But we hope to. We've already collected more than enough to cover those costs, and we hope, if everybody makes the phone calls, that we'll collect well in excess of $5,000 from potential sponsors. If enough is collected.
If enough is collected, in accordance with the brief.
Second motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
It's a movement second that Mr. Pearson be reimbursed by $1,263.64 if we receive the funds to cover that. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Even though we haven't done the corrections.
Yeah, we conditioner, but you only put it on the corner. So I just don't know that one. Now, hold on.
The mayor, Bob King.
Yeah.
Okay, council member.
You got that?
The mayor, Bob King.
Right. Council member.
Should have also have, back to Manny, because she does.
She's not part, she's not part of the, she's part of the public, but we split.
I know, but she has $32.98. And.
No, this is, this is the condo, this is the school.
Condo.
The condo.
And us too, right?
The student.
I think we fall under, Commissioner Manny.
Yeah, you and Manny, see, we're split now.
I know. They would also be using the culture center.
Yeah, the both would be.
I think it should have both of them. I think both Manny and Bob King should be on.
It wouldn't make any difference, I mean, it should make any difference, but on that. They're gonna sign, they're still included, they're pulling. They have a right to sign it.
You don't want, Manny changing the owner?
No.
Yes.
May Manny for some of her name?
Yes, I want her name on it too.
Huh?
Yes, her name should be on it too.
Yes, yeah, she's, five C.
Oh, four.
Oh, four, is that correct?
They need to add her name.
So, sure, maybe she's the one, she's still a, on board five.
She's been coming to me.
But she's crazy, she's here.
So, you know, we're living inside of this association, all the condo awards, we can sign them. And she should be telling us how to call the condo association presidents.
Well, I think she don't be representing.
We can't represent all condo awards.
No, so I'm talking about that, the condo is gonna be represented here tonight.
Yeah, but I'm just saying. Are they from there?
No, they're, I mean, they're from,
No, she's from Dickens.
Oh.
They support her in the town or something.
Oh, really?
They support.
I didn't know there was something that was gonna be about it. Maybe, see, that's the kind of politician, so we get the condo awards and the, it's amazing. So, that's. Yeah, I know, but that, council said they tell her they didn't come, come out to the meeting and, you know, make sure that she could. They didn't come to meet, so what?
What do you think we should do? I think whoever's representing that complex should sign it and put what complex they want.
I think that what you should do is get the letter corrected first, and then send each condo a copy of this letter.
Right.
And ask them to sign. That's what she said, sign, copy back for you. Give them, and then you submit the letter to. The possibility they want to see changes.
I'm gonna give you the information for person, possible representation.
Okay.
I'll give you the name then.
There's nothing, there's nothing here.
This is the office. This is the guy right here that she should be talking to. And then today, this person's secretary gave me this man, Mr. Anderson. So it's good to have both names. No, I'll just give her this right here. So this, whoever do the letter over can also tell me that this is a contact with Hawks.
Okay, Mr. Peterson, you have what we were saying?
Yes, ma'am, but I just passed it down.
Oh, okay.
make a motion that we make the necessary corrections on the draft copy, submit these, that copy to each cluster.
For the board of each condo association, right.
And have them sign it and return it to you, and then you will, with the correction, you'll submit the letter to Fox and Rex.
It's been moved in second, that would make the correction on the letter that we're going to send to Parks and Rec and send it to each board, each condo or complex to sign, and then bring it back to the association.
Once 13 clusters, signatures, then we can forward the letter to Parks and Recreation.
A second motion.
It's been moved in second that the letter attracted to Parks and Rec, including the corrections, be sent to each cluster in Fort Lincoln to the, for each year, to sign, and we'll, and send it back to the body to be sent to Parks and Rec. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, now we're down to the panel discussion. And it looks like it's only one panel member. So I guess we go with the one panel.
All you got.
That's right.
Except Mrs. Pearson.
So maybe somebody else will come in to meet them. You have any comments, Mr. Pearson?
Just saying that the moderator of the panel is supposed to be Bernadette White. She was supposed to invite all the panel members. She was supposed to moderate the discussion. Obviously, we had a disadvantage if she doesn't, she hasn't extended the invitation. Mr. Carmel and I have been in such ongoing communication email-wise that he certainly knew about it, but I think the others were waiting for an invitation from the chairperson of the Home Tour Committee. I dropped off letters to two people yesterday, but when I talked with Bernadette yesterday, she said she had not reached out to anyone, and she's been too preoccupied with her own physical issues to do so. So I think by default, the Capitol Hill Restoration Society, represented by Paul Cromwell, has been doing home tours for 56 years, is it?
Since the 56th year.
And has offered to share their experience with home tours with us to give us some idea of the history of their efforts, what obstacles they had to overcome, any pointers they have for us during our first one. The other person was invited who has experience is Bertha Holiday. She's the chairperson of the Home Tour Committee for the Bloomingdale Civic Association. It has been doing home tours, I think, for about 10 or 12 years. They do it on alternate years. And she, too, was going to share her experience. But like I said, although they got notice, they never got a formal invitation from Bernadette. And so there might be some confusion about whether or not, as I told them to expect the invitation, although I asked them to clear the date, and they both said they would be available. You know, she may have been waiting for Bernadette to invite her. So it turns into an opportunity for Mr. Cromwell, to the extent he's willing to please just share the experience you had with Capitol Hill Restoration Society and any instructive points you might have for us.
Okay, thank you for inviting me. And Mr. Pearson and I have had a number of discussions and exchanged emails over the last 6 weeks, would you say?
That's it.
I think you all have made great progress. That workflow plan you sent me the other day contains a lot of detail, and I think that's very good. We did, as I say, this is the 56th tour. On the first 10 tours, we probably had somewhere between 6 and 10 houses. We now do 12 to 14. Sometimes we've had as many as 20, sometimes as few as 6. We also do businesses. We've done a library as one of the 20. We've done a police station. But mainly it's houses. And there are two reasons to put a house on the tour for us. One is its historic character, because we are an historic district. And that doesn't mean we exclude something that's modern, particularly where an older building has been converted to condominiums. And also the furnishings. Less so now than in the beginning. I'd say in the 60s and 70s, there were people who had collections of things, people who had served overseas, and they really wanted people to come in and see their living room and their dining room. Now most people want to come in and see the kitchens and bathrooms. See what kind of countertop material is in there, who designed it. We don't get too many gardens. We get gardens that come to the house as opposed to a a house without a, or a garden without a house. There are, for you all, as you know, at Capitol Hill, there are a lot of front yards, and so we have occasionally prevailed upon owners of those front yards to allow us to have people stop. In one case, with box hedges, come in and examine them and whatever. I notice you've got some great posters over there, and you have sales outlets, I would guess, too.
Have what?
Sales outlets where you're selling tickets.
No.
I know you had a problem with Costco.
Yeah. So we don't have any retail stores that are selling tickets for us this year. That's something we might expand to in future years.
What we did, what we do with the retail outlets is that we confine it to places like insurance agencies where there's someone on the front desk, a small gift shop, only one person there. Wouldn't want to do it in a bar or restaurant because there's too many people running around. We don't keep excellent track of the tickets. We know where we give them to, namely the house captains for the days of the tour and our sales outlets. When we add them up in the end, if we're missing a few tickets, it's not anything to worry about. I think the main thing is that for those people who come through the tour, that they have a good time. And for those people who work on the tour, that they have a good time, so that they'll want to do it again next year. There are always lessons learned, and sometimes you can write things down, and sometimes people read what you write down, but it sure is great to have some carryover from one year to the next. Sitting here as you get involved in the tour and see how things go, making notes for yourself so that next year when the discussion comes along, it's there to do. We have always had a Sunday tea, and this probably was very nice in the 60s and 70s. Where,
well, if you point out that unlike ours, yours is a two-day tour.
We are 2 days. We are Saturday and Sunday. Unfortunately, we have our tour beginning the day. You have your tour coming. We've always run a tea on Sunday, and that's a holdover from the 60s and 70s when the ladies like to show up with white gloves. Actual tea in teacups. The last few years, we've had the tea in a bar. This year we have it at the American Legion Hall with an open bar. I'm sure there'll be a bit of tea there. It's just an added little thing. You know, if you go along, you think there's something nice to add, something that'll catch people's interest, something little people will say, wow, that's pretty nifty. Let's do that. That was so good last year. Let's try something like that again. We have, I've run the tour either directly or as a co-chair for the last 7 years, but not this year. And I would say that I had at least 15 people working on the tour, each with defined jobs, before tour day. And that's somebody to do publicity. Got to contact the Washington Post and some of the other things that come out of it. If you have a community newspaper, when they do their announcements, somebody's got to write those things. Somebody's got to write descriptions of the houses. I've had 5 to 6 writers each year to do those. And in our case, because the properties are historic, we do research on the houses to try and give a little context to it. Meanwhile, you have a whole planned community out here, and I would guess that in contrast to the historic part, the question of how do your houses fit into the plan, and why are they here, and why are they there, and how did it get planned this way? I don't know anything about Fort Lincoln other than it's somewhat new, and it's, what, 5, 6 years old?
Oh, oh my God.
Longer than that?
I've been almost 37 years, 35.
In Fort Lincoln, but the new buildings that are out here that have
passed? New, but you have some new, like 3 or 4 years old.
Okay.
You're talking newer ones near Costco.
Right,
This place has been here for many, many years, and it's built on, it used to be, I was told, a boys reform school.
National
Training School for Boys. Yeah. So it has a lot of history.
survey in this area that we need, right, that we could,
How many of your houses are more than 15 years old?
Oh, my God.
It's a lot. Other than coming, it was started in 1976. So they built five places
from 76 to 83, 85. Why was that?
I guess that's the part I'm saying.
I have a question. What are the boundaries of Copper Hill now?
If you're talking to real estate agents, it seems like it goes on forever.
Yes.
All the way up to Gallaudet.
Mm-hmm. And to the river?
And to the river.
Not
only east of the river, but south of the river. Right. If you're talking about the historic district, it's a defined area. And it goes out to about 13th Street, and it runs, roughly speaking, from F down to the freeway.
F?
What part is south of the freeway? The south, south.
It's my ass, because I grew up in what was called Stanton Park.
Yep.
Now that's Capitol Hill.
That is. But there's still a Stanton Park Community Association.
It is?
Yes. Someone told me the other day, it's not as energetic as it used to be, largely because the ANCs have in effect taken over a lot of what things like stand for.
And the changes in the communities.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, we try and tie it in not only to the history, but also to the lifestyle of what's going on. It's one of the reasons I like to involve commercial activities that are there. We have a photographer who goes around and takes photographs. We're not paying any of these people, by the way. The only people we pay are the printers who do the posters and the brochure. But the first 4 or 5 years, the Restoration Society mimeographed its brochures. And I've been trying to track down all the pieces for the first 4 or 5 years, so I haven't found them all. When tour day comes, we have house captains for each house. I like real estate agents because they've been taking care of people's houses for a long time. They know how to take care of a house and how to move people through it. And then we ask them to get docents. You kind of like to have a docent. A house ought to be covered with enough docents so that the docents can see everything. They might have to look that way and this way, but it's on a one-floor house, we get away with the house captain and two docents. Two floors, you've got to have somebody upstairs, but maybe we get away with one upstairs. Depends on how big the house is and whether it's laid out lengthwise or whether it's got a lot of turns in it. We ask homeowners if they value anything, whether it's worth money or not, but if they have some keepsake, we suggest they put it away. We don't, when we do have houses that have valuable collections of something, china, whatever, we don't put it in our brochures because those brochures get distributed wherever. What we do is that if there's a dining room that has a number of things that the docent would like to know what's in there, we get a picture frame and we type identifiers for everything in that room that people might ask about when they're coming through. So there's only one copy of that and it's in a picture frame, so it doesn't go away. As far as we know, we've never had a break-in that occurred as a result of someone coming on the tour. Of course, if you have a break-in 6 months later, it's kind of hard to tell whether that was true or not. But I think we've had a pretty good record of that. And as far as I know, we haven't had anything stolen either as people go through. You're always a little nervous about that. If you're a homeowner, you're a little nervous about it. But you got something, you know, it's your grandmother's, and it's small, maybe you want to put it away somewhere. Never can tell. We don't let little children come through at age five, up to five. If they come through, they have to be carried. We don't, of course, allow drinks to come in the house or food. The baby carriages stay outside. These are, I think, are all things that are in the house captain's instructions that we share.
I should mention that we do have a volunteer real estate agent who lives in the Dakota Crossing, who has volunteered to be the head house captain. And she is being tutored by one of your experienced house captains on recruiting other real estate agents who specialize in Fort Lincoln properties. Her name is Zenobia Wilson. She also advertises on our website. She is a realtor with Keller and something or other. But anyway, she's going to be the head captain, tutored by the person that you've identified as your experienced house captain. And she has a roster of about 10 real estate agents who will be assigned to the other houses that she will be recruiting and training for that purpose.
It's great experience. I mean, great visibility for real estate agents. And particularly you get some younger ones that may not be that well in the community. They can stand there. We let them say, fine, you want to hand out a business card? Go right ahead. You're part of the community. You're doing something for us. Feel free. Just don't get carried away with talking to somebody and ignore the people coming in. But our house captains greet every person coming through on the house tours. They may take a break and put somebody else in the front door for a while. But it's about making friends. It's about trying to make sure that everybody has a good time. We ask the homeowners not to be there, and that is because if 100 people come through and 99 people say something nice and one person says something bad about the house, that's the comment the homeowner's going to remember. So we tell them this. We can't tell them you can't be here, but we just prefer they not be in the house during the house tour. But we've had some owners that wanted to be their own house captains and recruited their own docents. Had a good time doing it, so it all depends on what their personality is like.
So what streets do your house do mostly on?
What streets are it on? Is it on?
The house, will they kind of scatter?
Well, good point, because for years they were scattered all over the hill and we had to provide buses. To bus people from one place to another. Well, for whatever reason, we got tour bus drivers from Reston. Maybe that's the only place we could hire them from, or that was the moderately expensive whatever, but they'd get lost. Now, for those of you that know the city, you know that the streets run north and south, east and west. You can ignore Maryland and Massachusetts and Pennsylvania. You don't get lost. Our tour bus drivers got lost. We had to put people on the tour bus. And then they'd quit at the end and then leave people stranded somewhere. So for the past 4 or 5 years, we have concentrated on a narrow area. This year, the tour is between South Capitol and 4th, southeast, below Pennsylvania, between Pennsylvania and Thruway. It's close enough, the homes are close enough together that we're a little worried that we are going to have lines standing outside the house. When they're stretched out a little bit, people have to take time to walk from one house to another rather than standing in line. But this year, they're fairly close. Last year, we had a mile and a quarter. If we walked the whole circuit, give them a mile and a quarter. And it was pretty flat ground. This year, I think it's smaller. But without the tour buses, which cost money, it brought us headaches. We're so happy we don't do tour buses anymore. But we have to, it limits the houses we could choose for house tours. They have to be within some designated area, or at least close enough to that area to be easily walkable. Because we don't want to